Alrighty, good morning, everyone. Welcome to you guys in the room and welcome to everyone online. Why don't we stand and let's pray together. God, we give you thanks this morning. We give you thanks that we are here, that you are here, and that we get to worship you. And so this morning, Lord, we just worship you and the splendor of your majesty. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The moon and stars, they wept. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world has fallen. His body on the ground, his blood poured out for us. The weight of every curse upon him. Final breath we gave as heaven looked away. The Son of God was laid in darkness. The battle in the grave, the war on death was waged. The power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake. The stone was rolled away. His perfect love cannot be overcome. Now death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated. Now forever he is glorified.
Glorified. my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. Let's do that verse again. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Yeah. Atmosphere and attitude of worship as we participate in communion today. This is a long-held tradition of the church commemorating the death of Jesus, celebrating, proclaiming, and receiving the grace that that death and resurrection promised for us. So I'm going to invite the ushers to come forward now, and Pastor Joel. We're going to continue with this song, trusting that in the receiving of communion today, there is a touch of heaven. There's grace for us. There's grace for healing. There's grace for provision. There's grace for conviction. There's grace for deliverance. There's grace for salvation as we eat of this bread and drink of this cup. So I have an usher in the back and an usher in the back for those wings. And then everybody else, as we continue singing this song, if you would come forward, receive the bread and the cup this morning, and then return to your seats, and we will take communion together once this song concludes. But I really just posture your hearts to receive a touch from heaven as we come to the Lord's table today. There's gluten-free up here.
And how I live for the moment where I'm still in your presence, and all the noise dies down. Lord, speak to me now. You have all my attention. I will linger and listen. I can't miss a thing. And Lord, I know my heart wants more of you. My heart wants something new. So I surrender all. desire is to know you. For a touch of heaven. Oh, 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 oh. You're the fire in the morning, you're the cool in the evening, the breath in my soul, the life in my bones. There is no hesitation in your love and affection. It's the sweetest of all, 'cause Lord, I know my heart wants more of you. My heart wants something new.
I am desperate for a touch of
Scripture says, for I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Jesus, we pause and consider your broken body. We pause and consider our need for a touch from heaven. And we open up our hearts to receive from you today. We ask that in the eating of bread, there would be healing for our physical bodies. There would be healing for our grief. There would be healing in our mind and our emotions. God, as we eat, we remember your brokenness for our wholeness. And we receive the grace that is offered us today. We receive the grace. We receive the grace. Help us understand your amazing grace to us and for us. Jesus, we remember your body in your holy and amazing name. Amen. Let's eat together. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Jesus, we thank you for the cup. And we thank you for the prophetic declaration of your presence still being powerful and present today in 2023 that happens when we drink of this cup. We proclaim your death. We proclaim the power. We proclaim the freedom. We proclaim the salvation. We proclaim the healing. We proclaim the access to you. God, we are desperate to know you more, to follow you, to be obedient. Today, would you have full access to our hearts? Come and do what only you can do. God, we thank you. And we declare your death over our lives, in our lives, and through our lives. In your name, Jesus, I pray. Amen. Let's drink of the cup. Just at the beginning of all that you have for us this morning. And pray that you would be honored and glorified as we continue with the word, with prayer, with connection and fellowship, God. Be honored in this place, in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, God bless you all. Turn and greet one another as you're seated today and extend the Lord's blessing to those around you.
Good morning, Northside. My name's Jonathan.
And I'm Jen, and this is what we have going on right now. Hi, church. Again, we're coming to you looking for some volunteers. We're hoping to start a midweek ministry for grades 5 to 7.
I'm Bianca.
I'm Victoria.
I'm Mila.
So, if you have a heart for this wonderful age, we're looking for a team of people probably to get started. And we're going to have an information session at the after service on, when was that again? November the 19th, I believe. Check the website for details, but we're looking for a team to come and teach these guys. Do you want someone to come say hi?
Hi! Please teach us.
Yes. As well as that fun bunch of students that we're looking for leaders for, we're also in need of some Sunday morning volunteers. It's always a need. So if you have capacity and energy and interest in serving in our kids zone downstairs on Sundays, please see Jasmine. She would love to talk to you.
Also, we're specifically looking for people interested in managing the audio on Sundays. So if you have an ear for music, you don't have to be technologically savvy, we'll train you with everything. We would love to have you come and join us part of the team and serve once a month, twice a month, whatever you feel up for. You can talk to me after the service or head to our website and fill out the tech volunteer form on our volunteer page.
And while you're on the volunteer page, there are a great number of options to volunteer here. So, you know, if tech isn't your thing and if kids aren't your thing, there are a few other areas. You are welcome to join our serving community. Women of Northside, we have another fun women's breakfast coming up on November the 18th. He can't come, but you are welcome to join us for some food and fellowship. There's such a great time. So please sign up on the website so we know how much food to prepare for. Prepare for. So thank you. Join us. You won't want to miss it.
See you there.
No.
We have two meetings happening after service this Sunday. First of all, if you are interested in membership at Northside and maybe even want to become a member, we invite you to our new members meeting happening in the boardroom downstairs after the service. Also, there's going to be a baptism meeting happening in the prayer room after the service. So if you're interested in being baptized or if you want to learn more about baptism, head to the prayer room after the service. Church, thanks so much for joining us for this week's video announcements.
And now sit back, buckle in, and pay attention for this wonderful word coming from Pastor Joel.
Bye.
Bye.
Good morning. It is so good to see you. I'm going to start off with dismissing our grade 5, 6, and 7, our rock class. If you are here and you'd like to go, you are dismissed. If you'd like to stay, something special in store for you. Somebody left their empty cough drop thing up here. Just get rid of that. But why don't we stand together, and I would like us to pray for each other, for the churches in our community, also pray for Israel, Gaza, as well as pray for me. So we're gonna do this as a community, okay? We won't hold hands because I'm just aware that some people don't like holding hands, but if you really like the person next to you and you like holding each other's hands, you can go ahead and do that. But the spirit has no distance. But I know that I just got points with all you introverts who said, thank you, Jesus. We don't have to hold hands. But the important thing is that we pray together. And so, first of all, we're going to pray to the person standing next to us. that they would receive from the Lord what the Lord has for them this morning. Secondly, we're going to pray for the churches in our community. We're also going to pray for conflicts in, if it's Russia, Ukraine, if it's Israel, Gaza, I will just allow you to be led as you feel led. There's conflicts all over the world, not just the one on the news, right? And so we want to give equal attention to all those that are suffering. Later in the service, we'll pray for the persecuted church together because this is International Day of Prayer for the Persecuted Church. And we'll be doing that as a community later in the service. But let's begin by just praying for the person to our left and right. Father, I pray that you would speak to them this morning, Lord, that their hearts would be softened to receive the word, to receive what you want to speak to them, Lord, this morning. I pray for peace over the person to my left and to my right. I pray that they would have calm, clear thinking, clear minds, Lord. We pray against any anxiety or trepidation or fear this morning and ask that you would minister to them in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. Father, we pray for the churches in our community, God. We remember them, God. We remember them by name, Lord. This morning, I pray for Coquitlam Alliance this morning, that you would bless them, Lord, that they would experience the presence and power of your Holy Spirit, God. I pray for Resonate Church, Lord, in Coquitlam and Pastor Shane and Rachel over there, Lord, that you would bless them, Lord, that they would see breakthrough in their congregation and in the community, Lord God. We pray for the churches in our community, Lord, and ask that you would bless each pastor and leader and teacher and each congregation member, wherever they might be. In Jesus' name, amen. Father, we pray for conflicts around the world, Lord. We pray for peace in Israel and Gaza at this moment, Lord. We turn our attention and our affection toward them, Lord, and ask that there would be peace, Lord. Ask that your spirit would counsel and comfort those in leadership, Lord. We pray for those in Russia, Ukraine, and also pray for peace, Lord, over that conflict. We release angels to these places in the world, Lord, to protect civilians, protect casualties that are caught in the crossfire, Lord. We ask that your angels would be dispersed, Lord God, and protect those in harm's way. And we pray all these things in the name of Jesus. And Father, we now just pray for me. Father, I pray for me. I pray, Lord, that you would speak to me and through me, and that I wouldn't get stuck or caught up in something that doesn't need to be said this morning. I humbly come before you as your servant, as a conduit of your presence and your purpose and your power and your word this morning. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Well, don't clap yet. I haven't preached yet. I'm just kidding. If one of the greeters would be so wonderful as to get me a cup of water, that would be wonderful. One of the greeters. Leader, maybe. Leader, could you get me a cup of water? Water? Agua? Por favor. I just spoke Spanish to a Chinese man. I'm sure that's going to go over real well. But me and Leader do love each other. And, you know, while we're at it, while we're thanking people in our community, we also have Alan on our soundboard. He's in the back. We have Ya upstairs changing slides. We have Peck as well doing our lights. We have Gan in production. We have Jonathan, who did the graphics this week. We have Rose, Pastor Rose, that sent out your sermon notes this morning. And we have other people behind the scenes that are helping and making this happen as well. Let's give them a round of applause. This morning, I want to continue our series. And our series is From Promise to Fulfillment. We are looking at concepts in the Old Testament, prophetic words in the Old Testament, people and anointings in the Old Testament that ultimately found their fulfillment in Jesus and through Jesus. And last week, Pastor Rose looked at the Good Shepherd, and we looked at Psalm 23. as well as the life of Jesus, how he is our good shepherd. And this morning, I'm going to look at a concept that some of you maybe have never heard of, and some of you might be somewhat familiar with, and some of you are very familiar with it. But I felt prompted by the Lord to speak on this topic because simply I believe this morning that there is more for you. I believe that the Lord has more for you. And if you will open up your heart and your spiritual hands this morning and your spiritual eyes this morning, I believe that he's going to give you something special. Just like this cup of water. Thank you, leader. Perfect timing. I'll pour it. Thank you. But I wasn't going to get this cup of water if I didn't ask for it. And I also wouldn't get this cup of water if leader didn't go and get it and deliver it. I will assure you this morning the Lord wants to deliver it. The question is whether you want to ask for it and receive it. Oh, that's good. I mean, that's refreshing. It just, I was parched. I mean, my lips were stuck together. I had cotton balls in my mouth. Not because of nerves, but just dryness. And sometimes we get dry. Anybody get dry? Oh, come on, really? You don't get dry? We all get dry, right? We all get dry. But the Lord this morning wants to posture us, our hearts, just with open hands just to receive. But you have to want it. The topic this morning is impartation. Impartation. God wants us to be empowered by impartation. You see, many of us, our main point this morning is that many of us are still operating with an old system, an old operating system. Sometimes if you're on your computer and you've used it for a while, this little box pops up, at least it does on my Mac, and it pops up and it says new operating system, upgrade. And you have to click it to get it. You have to clip it, you have to accept it in order to use it. And I believe that the Lord was saying this morning, some of you are operating with an old system. And he has a new software download for you. But you're gonna have to accept. Holy Spirit is desiring to download a fresh anointing this morning. As I talk about impartation, I want to talk a little bit about anointing. This is also a concept some of us are familiar with. Some of us have heard it at one time in our life or another time. Some of us are very familiar with it, but I want to talk about it because I believe that impartation is also a lesson on anointing. And throughout the Bible, we have the concept of anointing. Throughout the Old Testament, we see anointing for different things. And often the anointing will come with oil. Oil of anointing. I mean physical oil of anointing. But this physical oil of anointing represents something that is happening in the spiritual realm, which God somehow, through the prayer for anointing, God imparts his wisdom, his knowledge, his power, his understanding, his spiritual gifts. He imparts it through human beings to one another. In the Old Testament, we have anointing oil that was used. I'll give you a few examples of where it was used. When a slave would move to a new legal status of being set free, oil was used, anointing oil. In the transfer of property, if we were buying and selling property, and one person was buying it from another person, anointing oil was used in that ceremony to indicate a transfer of property. The engagement of a bride, there would be a ceremony held, and anointing oil would be used in that ceremony. again, a transfer of legal standing from single to engaged, betrothed. Another oil was used in the healing of skin diseases. Another anointing oil was used when they appointed and anointed kings, priests, prophets. There was this anointing oil that was placed on individuals as a symbol of God's anointing, God's power, God's purpose that is coming on an individual. Anointing oil was used when Moses transferred leadership to Joshua, and Joshua became the new leader of Israel. Anointing oil was used on the eighth day of purification for lepers, that when lepers were declared cleansed on the eighth day, they would anoint them with oil. Temple objects were anointed with oil. In the New Testament, the book of James, chapter 5, talks about when you go to pray for someone, anoint them with oil and pray for them. Now, oil in and of itself is not holy. Oil in and of itself, as you're walking through the grocery store and you see all this oil, it's not holy. It becomes holy when it is taken and it is set apart for purposes of God. So if you take regular olive oil in your home and you pray over that olive oil and you use it to anoint objects in your home, or you anoint your children, or you anoint your wife, or your wife anoints you, or you anoint your home, it now a regular object, because it's been set apart for purposes of God, it becomes holy. You don't need holy from Israel to pray for someone. But oil represents something very powerful. Pastor Rose and I had an opportunity this week to go and bless someone's home. Person had just bought a new place, and they wanted us to pray over their home. And so I brought a little bottle of oil, and we prayed over the different areas, the different rooms, and we just blessed this home. And I anointed it with oil, like there's oil all over this house now. But what was amazing about this concept is, you see, what was on me is now on the places I touch. The concept of impartation is God uses us to pray and impart the things that are on him, and they're transferred through us to be on each other. This morning, I wanted to watch a video, and this is the coronation of King Charles. There's some things in this video that jumped out to me for this message this morning, and so this is about 2 minutes long, and if you haven't seen the coronation, I want you to see it, and I want you to hear what is said when King Charles becomes king. So we're going to play that clip. It's about 2 minutes long, and then I'll continue my message.
Royal scepter, the ensign of kingly power and justice. And the rod of equity and mercy, a symbol of covenant and peace. May the Spirit of the Lord, who anointed Jesus at his baptism, so anoint you this day, that you might exercise authority with wisdom and direct your counsels with grace, that by your service and ministry to all your people, justice and mercy may be seen in all the earth.
Sacred anointing is done. Presentation of regalia complete. The moment of crowning has arrived. In the chair of St. Edward, with the crown of St. Edward, King Charles III is acclaimed.
And Lord of Lords, bless, we beseech thee, this crown, and so sanctify thy servant Charles, upon whose head this day thou dost place it for a sign of royal majesty, that he may be crowned with thy gracious favor and filled with abundant grace and all princely virtues. through him who liveth and reigneth supreme over all things, one God, world without end. Amen.
I don't know about you, but like, what a godly ceremony. Right after that, something interesting happens. They say together, "Long live the king." But sometimes I think we forget where the anointing comes from. Sometimes we forget that the anointing that I'm talking about this morning is from Jesus. And I believe that the Lord has this for you this morning. As I was watching this video, I felt like I saw with my mind's eye the Lord coming up to you and putting a crown on you. That he has anointed you for things. You may not think you're capable of it. You may not think you have the ability for it. You may think, I'm too old for it. I'm too young for it. I'm not educated enough. And whatever it might be, whatever those hurdles might be, he will crown you. And when he crowns you, he will give you the ability and the anointing to do what he has called you to do. I felt this picture of what was happening to King Charles was happening to us in this place. And some of you might think that's sacrilegious or something. I'm not sure. But the Lord wants you to rule and to reign with him, to be used for his glory. God is waking up his church. The days of coming and observing a professional pastor do ministry is over. You've been crowned. You've been anointed. Where there is anointing, there is appointing. And this morning, I believe the Lord has an impartation if you will take it. Turn with me to 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 7, as we make this official in God's word. Impartation is transferable. 50 men from the company of the prophets went and stood at a distance. This is the story of Elijah and Elisha. How many of you know this story? Okay, Rose, I might need some help this morning. Second Kings chapter 2, verse 7. 50 men from the company of the prophets went and stood at a distance, facing the place where Elijah and Elisha had stopped at the Jordan. Elijah took his cloak, rolled it up, and struck the water with it. The water divided to the ground to the right and to the left, and the two of them crossed over on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me, what can I do for you before I'm taken from you?" And Elisha says to him, let me inherit a double portion of your spirit. You have asked a difficult thing, Elijah said. Yet if you see me when I'm taken from you, it will be yours. Otherwise not. As they were walking along and talking together, suddenly a chariot of fire and horses of fire appeared and separated the two of them. Elijah went up to heaven in a whirlwind. Elisha saw this and cried out, my father, the chariots and the horsemen of Israel. And Elisha saw him no more. Then he took hold of his clothes and tore them apart. He picked up the cloak that had fallen from Elijah and went back and stood on the bank of the Jordan. Then he took the cloak that had fallen from him and struck the water with it. Where now is the Lord, the God of Elijah? He asked. When he struck the water, it divided to the right and to the left. And he crossed over. Lord, we just be with that ambulance or police car, wherever they're going right now, in Jesus' name. We pray for protection, provision, healing over the people they might be visiting. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. The company of the prophets from Jericho who were there watching said, the spirit of Elijah is resting on Elisha. And they went to meet him and bowed to the ground before him. An impartation is an upgrade. It's an upgrade from the Holy Spirit. Elijah had done ministry. He had seen miracles. He had seen healings. He saw creative miracles. We have 8 miracles or so documented in 1 Kings and 2 Kings. And Elisha is following Elijah around this whole time. And he's seeing the ministry of Elijah. And they come to a moment where Elijah takes off his cloak. I have a shirt underneath this. And Elijah takes off his cloak. This is all planned. Not really. And something happens. Elijah is taken up. Right before Elisha's eyes, Elijah is taken up. Elisha has asked a very difficult thing. He said, the one thing I want, think about this. The one thing I want is twice as much as what God did through you. Elisha would get twice as much. But I'm sure he didn't just have twice as many miracles. In fact, 16 miracles of Elisha are recorded compared to the 8 of Elijah. He had a double portion. But I'm sure he got double the frustration. Double the problems. Because with the anointing doesn't just come easy street. As Pastor Rose talked last week about the challenges of being in ministry. But Elijah goes up in this whirlwind, and his cloak with him, his anointing with him. And the Bible says that at some point his cloak came falling down to the ground. This is what Elisha has asked for. This is what he wants. And he goes and he picks it up. We read that Elijah's last miracle in his ministry is to split the Jordan. What does Elisha do? He rolls up the cloak, he goes up to the Jordan, and he's like, let's see if this works. I mean, really? And he bends down, touches the Jordan. He says, where is the God of Elijah? And something happens. The God of Elijah is the God of Elisha. The reason we know that the God of Elisha is the same is because the miracles are the same. But I believe that many of us don't realize that there's a cloak for all of us. It says that Elisha tore his cloak. Some of us this morning have to tear off the old to wear the new. Some of us have to take the old cloak off and throw it to the side to wear what God is calling us to wear. I was praying on Friday for this service. And as I was praying for this service, the Lord began to show me some interesting things. As I was praying for the service, I began to see with my spiritual eyes, I began to see purple cloaks coming down from the ceiling over this section. I began to see blue cloaks coming over here. I began praying over the seats in the sanctuary. And as I was praying over the seats in the sanctuary, God began to show me the people that were going to be here this morning. And he began to speak to me about your lives. You know what he didn't show me, though? He didn't show me any junk. He didn't show me any sins. He didn't show me any of those things that you're like, oh no, please. He's not going to, is he? He began to show me the purpose that he has for your life. The purpose that he has for your life this morning. And I want to share some of those things in a moment. This revelation that we have of Elisha from Elijah, this impartation of ministry, this anointing from ministry, it could not happen outside of the sovereign plan of God. And what Jesus shows us as we move into the New Testament and we move into the life of Jesus and we read from Luke chapter 4, we read about where this power comes from, where this anointing comes from, where this impartation comes from. It comes from the Spirit. In Luke chapter 4, verse 14 to 19, it says, Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit. Just before this, he was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. He was tempted by the Spirit. He was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to fight temptation. And now is the transfer. Now is this impartation from the Holy Spirit. Jesus has resisted temptation. And now it says he returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit. And news about him spread throughout the whole countryside. He was teaching in their synagogues, and everyone praised him. He went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day, he went into the synagogue, as was his custom, and he stood up to read the scroll of Isaiah. And he finds the place where it is written, the Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Jesus stands up in the power of the Spirit and he says, the Lord has anointed me in the power of the Spirit to proclaim. To proclaim good news. To proclaim freedom. To proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Jesus was anointed for this kind of ministry. And you might be saying, but that's Jesus. What does that have anything to do with me? The ministry continues. In Matthew chapter 10, verse 1 to 8, Jesus calls his 12 disciples to him, and he gave them authority. Everyone say authority. To drive out impure spirits and heal every disease and sickness. And these are the names of the 12 apostles. So Jesus calls the 12 disciples to him, the 12 apostles to him. And I want to read you the names. You might have forgotten. Simon, who's called Peter, and his brother Andrew, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, sons of thunder. Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew the tax collector, James, son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus, Simon the Zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Do not go out among the Gentiles or enter any town of Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. And as you go, proclaim this message. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. Jesus called 12 disciples to him. How many did Jesus anoint for ministry? Twelve. You might be saying, but Joel, okay, I'm not Jesus, I'm not Elisha, I'm not Elijah, I'm definitely not Peter or Andrew or James or John or Bart. But he anointed all 12. You know who's in the mix? The one who betrayed him. Are you a little better than Judas? I'm a little better than Judas. I'm going to claim that one. What happens is what we have made ministry is we've made it entertainment. And it is an impartation of the Holy Spirit. It is by the work of the Spirit, the power of the Spirit, that ministry is in operation. Jesus was full of the Holy Spirit. Jesus, who was fully God and fully man, chose to set aside his divinity to operate in the power of the Holy Spirit. The reason this was necessary, that Jesus operated in the power of the Holy Spirit, is to show us what was possible. The same Holy Spirit that raised Jesus Christ from the dead is where? It's in you. If this kind of ministry was only for the select few, why would Jesus say, go out into all the world, preach the gospel, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit? Why would Jesus say that you will do even greater things than me? Can you imagine if the 2.7 billion professing Christians were filled with the Spirit, led by the Spirit, empowered by the Spirit? I love doctors, I love hospitals, I love nurses, I bless them, we need them. But if 2.7 billion people were filled with the Spirit, we wouldn't need them. Judas betrayed Jesus. But before that, he was used by Jesus in the work of ministry. I believe that this morning the Lord wants to pour out his blessing. And I'm going to pause my message there. Because the last thing I wanted to do this morning was just talk about impartation but have no time for it. That would be hypocritical. But the question I want you to ask is do I want it? Do I want to be used by God? Do I want to receive from the Lord what he has for me? Again, there are cloaks that the Lord is dropping throughout the sanctuary. These cloaks that the Lord is dropping throughout the sanctuary in the spiritual realm are for all. There is no age restrictions. I love that in the service, there's like babies, there's kids running around, there's all kinds of, like, kids' ministry is in here this morning, which I'm actually saying is wonderful and purposeful in God's plan. Please don't take them downstairs. But when the cloak falls on them, steward it. We need everybody. We need everybody from 9 weeks old to 90 years old. We need everybody for this. But the question, I'm asking you an honest question is do you want it? As I was praying on Friday, I felt the Lord show me a few seats that were filled with amazing people. And I was actually praying over this side of the sanctuary, and Greg Baker was praying over this side. And Greg, you can come up if you ever feel the desire to or want to, but I just want to share a few things that I felt. Is that okay? So what I'm going to share is I'm learning in all of this, so I need your grace, but I really feel like I have to be obedient to the Lord this morning. And so I'm going to be obedient to the Lord, and if you would give me grace, that would be wonderful. I was praying over here in this section, and the Lord showed me, I actually forgot the seat, but it was the fourth or fifth seat back on the aisle underneath that speaker. So that would be kind of, is that Garrett? Garrett, I just want to, would you stand for a moment? I just want to share something for you. I just want to tell you, like, I felt like the Lord was saying you're doing an amazing job at work. And I felt like the Lord was saying that there was, I'm just going to read this to you, and you can take it and talk to me after. But you may have felt in the past like people over you, overseers, maybe had it out for you. But I felt like the Lord was saying that like Joseph, you're going to receive a promotion. You're going to find favor, great favor. And I just wanted to pray over you that you would receive that from the Lord this morning. Is that okay? Father, I just pray right now for Garrett, Lord, that he would receive what it is that you have for him, Lord. That you would make sense of what you want to make sense of, Lord. That you'd bring to his heart understanding around that, Lord. I bless him. And I do pray for that promotion, Lord. Not for just for him, but to put a seal on this story over his life. I pray for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. The next thing I felt as I was praying was in the fifth row along this aisle. 1, 2, 3, 4. So Doug and Ruth. But I actually thought this was for Mark and Aaron as well. I felt the Lord was saying that he's going to pour out a healing anointing on your lives. Could you four stand? He's pouring out a healing anointing on your lives. And he said this to me, I have an anointing for the gifts of healing because it's something that has been, like, there's been let down. There's been moments where people have been prayed for in your lives that have been just difficult, moments of loss, moments, and the Lord is saying, I want to renew and restore faith for healing over you and over your lives. And so I just want to pray that the Lord would pour that out upon you, that you would be filled with the Spirit, that God's healing anointing would begin to flow through you. And I know there's questions, I even see them now, like, now, Lord, we've tried this, like, I've tried that, we just lay down all the previous trials, and we ask for the anointing of the Spirit and a fresh impartation to come upon you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Thank you. This is really, like, just so you know, this is the last thing I wanted to do this morning because it's hard. But there's something about doing what's hard because you have to be obedient. And unfortunately, that means way more to me than feeling good. On the right side of the back wing, I actually saw like a wave of the Holy Spirit from right to left. So it was moving from right to left, and then as it moved back left to right, the Lord showed me a few people in the back wing. There's someone in that wing, I'm not sure which seat, that suffers with tremendous nightmares and night terrors. Is that anyone in the back wing? Tremendous nightmares, night terrors, difficulty sleeping. No one back there? Yes, in the very back. I believe that the Lord is giving you a discerning of spirits, an anointing for the discerning of spirits, that he is going to show you how to use this, what the enemy is meant for evil as he's coming against you in the night, that the Lord is going to use that to be used for the kingdom of God. And you're going to be used powerfully in prophetic ministry, in discerning of spirits specifically. And so I just want to bless you in that. Do you want it? I bless you in that. There's a weightiness to it. There's sometimes a heaviness to it because you begin to, it's like the scroll is rolled back and you begin to discern what's happening in the spiritual realm, and that can be difficult. But the Lord will provide the strength and the courage and the anointing for that. And I just bless you in that in Jesus' name. Amen. There's a married couple. I think it's Andre and a married couple on the right side in the two chairs. I can't totally see you. Is that Irene and Andre? Okay, good. Because I wrote down that it was an Asian couple, and you were in those seats. Would you stand and just hold hands? I believe the Lord is blessing this first love. Like, you guys fell madly in love. I just saw such a beautiful, pure love. Like, when you guys met, you, like, fell head over heels madly in love with each other. And I just felt the Lord saying, I'm going to rekindle that flame, like, that burning, passionate flame in your marriage. And I just bless you. I just bless you in that. Father, I just pray for just an anointing of your Spirit upon them, that they would be used powerfully and mighty for your kingdom, God, to show what a husband and wife that are in love, not just on paper, but in love, God, what it looks like. We just bless their marriage, Lord. We just thank you for the anointing on their lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Bless you. Is there anyone here that's a mechanic? Mechanic? mechanic, mechanical. Anyone want to be a mechanic? Anyone know a mechanic? No mechanics here? Okay. I would say on live stream, but our live stream was is down this morning. Go figure. All by the Lord's plan. Okay, well, if you are a mechanic or the mechanic went to the washroom, I'd like to talk to the mechanic after the service. The Lord has awesome things for you. Okay, I'll just share one more that we're going to move to. This is just kind of funny, but right here in this section, there was like four seats. So it was like just behind Greg is a father and is that your daughter? Yeah. You don't have to stand. And then the two behind, which is Fred. These four seats, there was, this is just kind of a weird picture, but there was like a, how do I describe it without sounding weird? There was a column of like fire coming down right on those four seats. And it was almost like an open heaven, what some would describe as an open heaven. But the Lord said like you're going to sense it and feel it. And so I just want to pray for you. Again, what does that mean? I actually have no idea. I have no interpretation for that. But I just want to pray that over you. Father, I just pray that whatever that is, Lord, that you would bless them, that you would show them, Lord, what does an open heaven mean? Just like a flame of fire, Lord, going up and down. They would gaze into your beauty and your presence. Flame of love, come and rest upon them. These two fathers and children, that's not a coincidence. That you would move through these men as they impart to their children the goodness and glory and power of God. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen, 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 amen. I'd like to invite the worship team to come up. And we're not on live stream, but we wanted to take some time at the end of our service to also pray for the persecuted church. And again, we're still not on live stream, right? So after we sing this last song, I'm going to invite Kevin to come up and pray. And he's going to be praying for the persecuted church in China. There's persecuted churches all over the world. And so I know even in Iran and places like North Korea, places in Africa, like obviously the Middle East, like... But we want to, after we close in worship, we want to pray for those places. And so I'll let the worship team lead us. And then if Kevin could get ready, and then we'll close in prayer.
Gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer. There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to Him. And oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ. Night is dark, but I am not forsaken, for by my side the Savior, He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need His power is displayed. To this I hold,
yeah, not I.